H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.
Today we are going to discuss about parameterization. Parameterization is an automation concept. Okay, if you understand this parameterization concept, it will be the same concept that you will use in Selenium, you will use in QTP or in other tools too. Okay, so first of all, try to understand what is meant by parameterization. Okay, first understand the concept, then the implementation will vary from the tool to tool. Okay, so what is meant by parameterization means it is replacing the hard-coded values with the parameters will be called as the process of replacing the hard-coded values with the parameters will be called as parameterization. Here I have used a word called hard-coded. Then what is meant by hard-coded value? Here hard-coded value means, say for example, I'm automating a login scenario. Okay, till this point we have been using keeping the data here in the script itself, right? I mean to say here, for example, for example, if you go to the script here, we have written a logic for eBay. Now if you all observe here, camera is the value which we were using. Camera is a hard-coded value here in the script. Okay, I mean to say here in the eBay application, in the script actually we were using a camera for searching. Okay, this is called as hard-coded value. Okay, this is a hard-coded value. For example, here in the yesterday session where we were discussing this handling alerts, here in this handling alerts, if you observe here a full name. Here, say for example, I have entered full name as Selenium, okay, and say mobile number is something like this, okay. So this is the mobile number and this is the email ID, and here is the city, okay, and here is the salary. These are the values that we have mentioned directly in the script, okay. Now, if I execute this script, it is going to use these values for executing the script, right? If I execute this script, this value Selenium, I mean full name as Selenium, mobile number as this number, and email ID is this. This is going to use this data. Okay, fine. Say if I execute this script for 100 times, what will happen? If I execute this script for 100 times, it is going to execute with the same set of values for all iterations, right? I'm saying here, if I execute this script for 100 times, for each and every time, it is going to use the same set of data, right? Because here I have hard-coded it. Okay, this hard-coded means we have mentioned the test data here in the script itself. Okay, now the process. Now we will remove this hard-coded values. Now we will remove this hard-coded values. We will try to mention the parameters. Okay, or we will try to retrieve the data from some source, and we will try to mention over here. Okay, This process is called as parameterization. Okay, so mentioning the test data within the script itself is called as hard-coded values. Okay, now we'll remove these hard-coded values with parameters. So it means basically we will keep the test data outside to the script. Okay, so keep the test data outside to the script and read it from there. Okay, it means just keep all the test data external to your script and read the data from there. So from the external file you can manage your test data. Okay, every time you don't need to touch your script. Okay, so if you want to execute this with a different set of data, say you don't need to come here, say you don't need to change the data over here. Okay, the advantage if you go for parameterization, every time we don't need to touch our script. Say here we have around 5 to 6 values. By chance if you miss one value, unnecessarily our script execution will fail, right? See here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Here if you observe 5 inputs, we have to give here in this, even here this one, 6, this one, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Here we are feeding, we are giving 6 different input values. Say by chance if you miss one value, unnecessarily our scenario will fail, right? Say I want to execute one salary range with whose value is less than seven digits, okay, something like that. So if I miss it again, unnecessarily our scenario is going to fail. Okay, so that is the reason, that is the other reason we'll try to keep all of our test data in a single place, so that from that single place we will try to manage it. Okay, so we'll keep the test data outside to the script and we'll read it from there. Okay, so here we can keep the test data in text files, okay, even XMLs, Excel. Okay, we can keep our test data here in text files, XMLs, Excel, or whatever the format that you can, whatever the other files that you can mention, you can do that. But here Excel is the preferable one, because here in Excel you'll have this columns, right? You'll have this column structure, you'll have this row structure. Okay, now you go for any automation tool. Okay, it might be QTP, it might be Selenium, whatever the tool, generally Excel is the preferable. Okay, we'll keep our test data here in Excel. Okay, so here we'll keep the test data here in Excel. So let me take one Excel file here. Now see here, we'll try to parameterize this quick apply over here. Okay, now here we are passing car loan, right? So loan type is the column name. I'm preparing it as data here. I took a new Excel file. Okay, I'm preparing the columns here. First of all, type loan, full name, mobile number, mobile, email ID, city, net salary. Okay, but these are the inputs that we are giving over here. Now see here, loan type here, as I said, here it should be accurately mentioned. So I'm mentioning car loan here. Okay, full name, let me say Selenium, mobile number, let me say, okay, an email ID, abc1@df.com. Okay, city, here let me say as of now here Pune. Net salary, and let me say, okay, so here this is the test data over here. Okay, now let me save this. Okay, Here, I just keep the test data over here. Let me give a sheet name. Let me say quick apply. So, for this quick apply scenario, I'm just keeping all the test data over here. So, if I want to use this script, I will not touch this script. I'll come to this Excel file and simply in a single place, I will change the data over here. Okay, the advantage is here, while changing in the script, you may forget something here. And here, moreover, here we have 6 values only, but in real time, it may be 10 to, it might be more than 6. Okay, one thing. And here, as of now, I'm just discussing only one scenario, but here in real time, when you want to execute a script, probably you may execute some set of scenarios, say it might be 10, 15. So for each scenario, you have to update the data, means you have to scan your scripts and you have to update the data. If you forget one value, unnecessarily scripts may fail. Okay. One reason, technically I can say, it's like managing the test data. Okay, managing the test data here in the script itself, it is a problem. So that is the reason we will manage the test data here in Excel files. Okay, now let me save this file and save this file as .xls. Here I'm saying save as. Let's see here, I'm keeping the test data file over here. Okay, let me say deal for loans test data. Okay, I'm giving the name with the deal for loans test data, and here I'm going to say XLS. Okay, so I'm mentioning XLS here. I'm saving this is in 97-2003 format. Okay, I'm saving under this particular folder. Okay, so this is how I prepare the test data and I'm managing it. Now coming back to the topic here, okay. So I said, in any automation tool, generally we'll keep the test data here in Excel because of its advantages. Like here we'll have columns and rows, so we can easily maintain our test data. Okay, yep. Maintaining like columns and rows here in text file, it is very hard, right? And XMLs, again, it is you have to write the XMLs. So in general, any automation tool, generally we prefer Excel to keep to maintain our test data here. Okay, now what I said here, we have to read the we prepared the test data over here. Now here we need a logic. That logic should read this test data from here Excel, right? Now we need a logic. That logic should read the test data from here in the Excel. Reading test data. Reading test data, we don't have anything. With respect to Selenium. Okay, we don't have anything in Selenium to read the Excel. Okay, reading the test data is nothing but reading the Excel, right? Technically, I'm talking. So here in this case, reading the test data, which is nothing but reading Excel. So we don't have anything directly in Selenium WebDriver. Okay. Instead of, Selenium WebDriver. In Selenium WebDriver, we don't have anything to read the data in the Excel. Okay. Now this is related to the language that we have chosen. It means, I mean to say here, this is purely related to Java. Okay. By using Java language, we are reading this test data, we are reading this Excels, okay, not based on the Selenium WebDriver. Okay, by using Selenium WebDriver means here we have been using some Selenium inputs right here, like OpenQL, Selenium.alert, Selenium, here we have some set of files are there, right? So I'm saying we don't have anything like this, like we don't have any supporting functions from Selenium to read the test data. Okay, it is related to Java. Okay, so again here in Java, you can read Excel in two ways, using JXL, using POI. It means, I know I'm talking about jar files. Here again, we have ready-made methods here in Java. Okay, here in Java we can read Excel in two ways. One is by using jxljar POI jar. All of you know about this jar, right? Jar means, if you remember, Selenium WebDriver jar files, Java archive repository files, Java library files. In generic terminology, I can say Java library files. Okay, we have a predefined JXL jar files and the POI jar files. Most of the people, most of the automation testers use a JXL jar file. Okay, because JXL jar file, it will be easy to understand. And even the size of this jar file is around 600 KB. Whereas the size of this POI jar. POI jar means by using this POI library file also we can read the Excel, but it will be like very advanced and very robust methods will be available here in POI, but which we actually don't require. We just need a scenario where in which we can read the data from the Excel, simple. Okay, so here in POI it is around, I think around 28 MB, the file size is, let me say 30 MB. Around 30 MB. I mean, if you observe here the size itself, the POI jar file is around 30 MB, whereas this JXL jar file is 600 KB. Okay, so here in our class we are going to understand JXL. Okay, by using JXL jar file, we are trying to understand the parameterization here. Okay, so first of all, let me take a new class here. And here in special cases, let me capture this one. I'm just copying this handling alerts. Just up here, I'm just, and then the other way, I'm actually captured this one. Yeah, let me say instead of handling alerts, again let me say quick apply. Okay, here I'm just removing this alerts part. Okay, yeah, this is where we are going to parameterize. Let me close all other things. See here, here in our class we are going to use JXL to read the test data. I know why, because it is easy to understand, and for automation level we generally want to read the test data from Excel. In general, we will come across like reading the test data from Excel. So for that, JXL is enough for us. Okay, and moreover, the other thing is, the size of this JXL file is 600 KB and the size of this POI is around 30 MB. which we don't bother about, but I'm just saying a point over here. Okay, now here I already wrote some set of methods by using JXL. Here let me copy from my previous project. See, there is something called Excel read. I'm just copying this file. Let me paste here in my this default one. Now actually I have copied a file called Excel read, and if you all have read this Excel read, in this Excel read is now Excel read. This is the class. Okay, in this class I have created some reusable methods. Reusable methods means which you can use across any project. Now if you see here, there is a method called column counter. This will help you in finding the number of columns. If you really come across any scenario, if you want to find number of columns in the Excel file, you can use this particular method here. Okay, and there is something called row counter. Row count means to find how many rows that we have data here. Say if you have 5 rows of data, this row count will help you to find. This method will help you to give how many rows are there in the Excel. Okay, and here we have something called get cell data. And if you all give a minute. So here if you all agree here, get cell data. What is this called as? Here we have two method names with the same name. Two methods with the same name. What we call it as? Actually what I'm saying here, Excel read is a class. This I have written for my project. Okay. Excel read, this is a class. This I have written for my project. And here we are going to have some set of methods. By using this set of methods, we can basically read the test data. Not only reading the test data, we can find the number of columns, number of rows. Okay. Yep. Here again, I can see two answers here. If you all observe here, I said here two method names are same. Yep. What we call it as? If I can see two correct answers, and what about the others? Three answers, four, yep, that's correct. Yep. Here this is called as method overloading. If you remember, I said, I will show a practical example of method overloading in coming classes during the Java. I just explained what is meant by method overloading. And I gave a very good example, system.out.println, where println is a method where you can find some around 10 to 15 different println methods. Each println method is different. Okay. Here also, if you observe here, get cell data is a method, name is same. It means the purpose is same. Both the things will read the test data here. Okay. Get cell data means basically why we have written this function. When I say get cell data of this, okay, I can give the column number, I can give the row number. That is what you can observe here. So get cell data, row number, column number. It means if I pass 1, 2, get cell data of 1, 2, it is going to read the data from here. Okay, are you getting what I am saying? If I say get cell data of 1, 2, okay, it is going to get the row number 2, 2, okay. It is going to read the data from here. Okay. And if you observe here, I said get cell data, and here I can pass a column name and the row number. There is a difference, right? Both the things, both get cell data, the purpose is same. Both are helping us to read the data. Okay. But the way that is different. Here one case I am passing the row number and column number. That's it. In the other case I am passing the column name. What is the column name and what is the row number? Okay, of course, in both the cases, it is reading the test data. Okay, and moreover, if you observe here, what is the returning type of this method? What it is returning? What this particular method is going to return? Yep. It is going to return string. If you observe here, I said public string. Okay, see here, I said public string, get cell data, and here I am passing two parameters. So one is row number and column number here, and here also it is returning the string. Okay, here also we are returning the data string here, get cell data, we are passing the column name and the row number. Okay, this is one of the good example for the method overloading. Okay, and moreover, if you observe a row count, what is the returning data type? What is the written data type over here? This is integer. Okay, now however, you know, these are the set of methods that I have written for one of my project. Okay, I'm going to share this Excel file, this Java class file. You can also use the same thing. Okay, here it is a predefined methods. Okay, it is accordingly written in my project. Okay, it can be customized. It can be customized, and you can write your own methods. Okay, again, for this we actually know in depth of JXL. Okay, but this should be fine. Okay, and moreover here, why this is showing the errors? Any guesses why it is showing the errors? And if you observe here, I have used a set of JXL files here, JXL related things for this class. Okay, why it is showing the errors? Any guesses? Any guesses?
JXL jar file packages.
Yeah, but that's correct, Devon. Yeah, I'm trying to find from others. If that's correct. If that's correct, Uma. If any other cases from anyone? Yep, here, if you remember, here I said, no, JXL, here we are using JXL jar file, and this is the logic which is built based on the JXL jar file. But for this project, for our project, I did not configure the JXL jar file, right? How to configure a jar file to our project? Any guesses? How to configure a jar file to a project? Yep. Okay, let me ask the question like this. I know, how did we configure the Selenium WebDriver files to our project? Did you remember? How did we configure Selenium WebDriver jar files, Selenium WebDriver files to our project? Yep. Again, and remember this, whenever you want to whenever you want to add any external jar file to your project, not only Selenium WebDriver, not only JXL, it might be any jar file, you have to go right click on the project. Here, go to the properties. And let me show where we need to download the, from where we can download the JXL jar file. You can download the JXL jar file from the over the internet. Let me show that also. Now where we have to configure jar file. Java build path. Right here, right click on the project, Java build path, and libraries. Click on add external jars here. Okay. And meanwhile, let me show JXL, how to download JXL file. And here in my case, I already downloaded the JXL file. See here, in the installation folder, there is something called JXL. In my machine, I already have the JXL, but JXL was not configured to this particular project. Okay. See, I am selecting JXL over here. So if I once click on OK, all these errors will be vanished here. Okay, because here I have configured the JXL. Okay, now let me say OK. So now all these errors will be gone. I just saved. See here. Okay, now here. If you go to Google, you can say JXL jar file download. Yeah, this website is the good one. Okay, let me ping over here in the chat box. Okay, share. No, this is the website. Okay, you can find the JXL jar file from here and click on this. It is going to download here. Okay, and moreover, let me also mention this here in our class transcript. JXL jar Now here even I have a methods to write into Excel, write to Excel. Okay, here I have to pass the file name, sheet name, and to which column, to which row, and what is the data that you want to pass. Okay, here write to existing file. Again, we have to pass the file name. Where is the file name? What is the sheet name? What is the column? What is the row? What is the string? Okay. But however, for the parameterization purpose, we require this get cell data, okay, and this row count. Now see here. Now here I want to parameterize this script. Okay. Now I have to make I have to make use of this Excel read over here in the parameterization. Okay. Now how I can make use of this Excel read over here in the parameterization class? How can I make use of this Excel read here in the parameterization? What I have to do over here? Yep, that's correct, Harita. I'm saying I want to use this Excel read. Okay, I want to use this Excel read. And moreover, if you all observe here, can you observe here? There is Excel read here. What is this called as? Excel read is a class name, and here is there is something you can find Excel read. Okay, here I have a constructor here. Okay, again this is one of the good example for the constructor. Okay, here when I say now let me show this. It is another example for a good example for the constructor. Now see here. However, if I want to make use of this Excel read here in the parameterization, I have to create the instance. Right, I have to create the instance of this Excel read. So how to create an instance here? How to create an instance? Class name, object name, right? So class name is Excel read. So when I say Excel read, automatically it is going to be imported over here. Of course, it is not going to be imported because both of them are in the same package. Okay. Now CL Excel read. Now let me say OXL. OXL is the object name. You can give any name. You can mention A, B, C, D or anything here. I am just mentioning OXL. OXL is the object name here. New Excel read. Now everyone observe here, while creating the instance, I have two options here. I can create an instance for a dummy thing. It means it will just create an instance for Excel, that's it, okay. But here I want to create an instance for this particular file, for this particular sheet I want to create an instance, okay. Here I have two options, see here, Excel read, okay. If I create an instance, if you remember, I gave one of the example for Olga's question, I said, buying a car. First we are buying a car, then we are painting it, and then we are customizing accordingly based on our needs. Okay, it will be like this. If I create an instance for this Excel read, first of all I am creating the instance, then again I have to pass the parameter like file name and sheet name separately. Instead of that, directly if I pass this file name and sheet name, while creating the instance itself, it is going to create the instance at the sheet level. For this sheet, it is going to create the instance. Okay. So here the preferable one is Excel read. See here I'm going to pass the file name here and sheet name, so that I can directly create the instance for this sheet itself. Okay. First of all, instead of creating a instance for a normal this Excel read, then passing these values may not be a preferable one. Okay. Now what is the sheet name over here? This is the sheet name. And here we have to give the Excel file name. Excel file name means basically we have to give the path of the Excel. Okay. Here we have saved this Excel here in class. TK Emphasis. And Selenium. Yeah. Okay. Here I have saved this file. So let me copy from here. And what is the file name? This one. This is the file name. So I'm mentioning this. Dot Excelus. And if you have file name, what we have to do? We have to mention double slashes, right? Now I have created the instance, basically indirectly I have created the instance for this particular Excel sheet here. Okay. Now here I am using OXL. Now here basically we are passing this car loan here directly, right? Now everyone agree here, I am removing this car loan. Okay. I am trying to read this particular data here. Okay. If I want to read this particular data, what we have, which method we have to use? I have created the instance OXL. Okay. Here observe here, I am removing this hard coded value here. This is a hard coded value. Okay. Now see here. Here basically I want to read this data, right? So if you observe here, we have get cell data. We can pass the row number, column number, but it is preferable to pass the column name. Okay. See here OXL dot get cell data. So by using this method, I am reading this data. Okay. Here we have to pass the here we have to pass the column name. Okay, so this is the column name. Okay, and then we have to pass the row number here. See, I'm passing one. Okay, similarly we have to keep this particular thing. See here I'm keeping this over here. Now observe here, I'm removing this QTP here. And it means its full name. So I'm just removing the hard coded values and I'm replacing with this parameterization instance. And now let me use this column name over here. Okay, so I just replaced the hard coded values with this parameterized related concept. Okay, I'm saying you have get cell data. Just now we have discussed about this method, right? Get cell data, which is going to read the data from the Excel, and here we have to pass the column name and the row number. Okay, now we'll try to execute this particular class here. We'll try to execute this particular method. Now it has to open the browser and it has to do a quick apply. We'll wait for a while, we'll let it open. Yep. Yep. See here, observe the right side section. Yep. See here, it is just entering, it is reading the data from the this one. Okay. See here, of course, it seems we did not select this checkbox. That's the reason they're saying accept the terms and conditions. Okay, but however, if you observe here, this is the data that we are passing from the Excel, right? Car loan, Selenium, this. Okay, Any questions till this point? Generally, it is preferable to close this Excel during the execution, but I did not change. I did not close, but you know, it is preferable to close this data. Okay, this particular Excel because sometimes it may get crash. Yep. Any questions? See here. Here I have prepared the 5 sets of data here. Now I want to execute this scenario with 5 sets of data. Okay. Now what is the approach? Simply we have to first we have to find the number of rows here. We have to find rows of data. Okay. And then we have to read the data for each iteration. We have to read one rows of data here. Okay. So now how can we find the number of rows here? How can I find the number of rows here in the Excel? Just now we have discussed a method called row count here. Okay, so that is the reason in real time we generally use these two methods: get cell data, row count. Row count will help us in finding the number of rows here. So first of all, see here. Observe here. Okay, let me take the one. Let me take the this scenario. Let me copy this method. And here I'm pasting here, and let me say here, click apply, multiple rows. Okay. Now here, I'm trying to find the row Excel dot this row count. Okay, row count is the method. So it will help us in finding the number of rows. So here let me get, it is going to give an output integer. So let me say integer I number of rows. Okay, I'm capturing that value into a variable. Now here I'm writing a for loop. For each iteration I want to execute it, right? So for I equal to, here I'm saying for int I equal to 1, I less than or equal to I number of rows. I plus plus. Okay. So I'm writing here the logic in for loop. Okay, I'm keeping this all this logic in a for loop. Okay, now here we have mentioned one, right? Now this has to be replaced, because if you mention one, it is going to execute with one. Now what I have to use over here, if that's correct, Devon? Yep. Any other guesses from anyone here? If you mention here get cell data of one, it is going to read the data from one. I mean, it is going to read the data from the first row only. Okay, but here each iteration I want to use different sets of data, right? How can I? So what is the data? What is the what I have to use here? So you have to use I, because here I is the iterator, right? Here I is the iterator, so here we have to use I here. Okay, see, I'm just replacing all these things with I. Okay, yeah. And let me give some wait time here, but otherwise we'll not understand what exactly it is doing. Let me give some 3 seconds. Okay, and let me also just comment this. Sometimes it will go to next page. I'm just commenting this, clicking on submit. Okay, I'm just commented this, clicking on submit over here. Okay. Now see here, let me execute this scenario here. I think that's it, right? I'll try to execute this. I would have closed this Excel file. Yep. Any questions meanwhile? It's simple here. I'm just reading the data. I'm just finding the count. Here I'm just finding the count. I have written a for loop. So for that many iterations, for that many count, it is going to iterate. Okay. Any questions so far here? Yep. Here, yes, Anil. Here, you know, actually, here we are going to check, whether it is going to iterate properly or not. Okay, whether it is going to enter the data here or not. Actually, yes, I understand. Here, it is not. We have written a, it's not a complete scenario. Okay. Actually, here it is like once you fill the information, once you click submit, basically you are going to the next page. Okay. And again, from the next page, again you have to come back to the quick apply. We did not handle that, right? We are simply mentioning the for loop, just entering the data. Okay, we did not actually handle. Once we click on submit, again it has to come back to the quick apply, right? So that is not the handle. That's the reason I'm not clicking on submit. Yep. Any other questions? Any technical questions over here? Any questions on parameterization? Yep, you can you can treat it as an assignment and give a try it, Anil. Okay, just do it from your end. Yep, see here, everyone observe here. It has first of all it has entered the first set of data. I'm just maximizing from my end. So now it is entering the second set of data. Now it is entered the third set of data. Okay, four sets of data. Fifth one. Okay. Why it is failed? Oh, here can you all agree here? I know here I said number of rows I less than or equal to. It means what happened here? It find the count of six. Okay. If you observe here, a and here, if you observe here, okay, yes, here out of bound exception six. It means here number of rows it retrieved the six, but the first row is the column name, right? First row is the column name. What I'm saying here in the Excel, here in the recent, here, first row is the column. So we have to exclude it, right? When I say row count, it is just said six. Okay, it pulled out six, but first row is the column name. So we have to exclude it. Okay, so that is the reason here we have to mention I less than or equal to number of rows, then it is going to be passed. Okay, and here, why I was not clicking here submit here, okay, and Abdul here, I'm not clicking on submit over here, because if you submit, it may go to the next page. Of course, here as of now, it is saying accept the terms and conditions, but sometimes even though you did not select this checkbox, it will go further. Okay, there is a bug. If you iterate during iteration, if you click submit for two or three times, it is going to the next page. Okay, even though you did not select these terms and conditions over here. Okay. So that's the reason actually I have just as of now here I was just commented this. Okay.
Yeah. H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys. How we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.